most of the speakers in edible education, me included, have been of a certain age, or let's say gray beards. And it's perhaps difficult for some of you to look at us as role models since we've been at this for so long. But tonight is different. We have Sara, Mersha, and Anim Steele here. And they are scary smart young people working at doing the right stuff. And for those of you looking to make a difference in food, these are your new gurus. Sara has been director of grant making and advocacy at Grassroots International since 2010. And Grassroots International works around the world to help small farmers, producers, indigenous people, especially women, win resource rights, human rights to land, water, and food. Grassroots funds community-led initiatives and movements and advocates for social justice in pretty much all spheres. Sara has traveled to much of the world in the course of this work. She was born in Ethiopia, where many of her family still live on land they've been farming for generations. She moved to the U.S. when she was 4 years old with her father and her mother, who was a nurse in the Peace Corps in Ethiopia. She'll talk about the importance of social movements in food sovereignty, in food security, and climate change, and why it's important to do this work in the United States. When I came here in January, one of my goals was to help reform, or shall we say modernize, the dining services system at Berkeley. And in this I failed miserably, mostly for lack of time, but we will get there. Anim is doing this work on a much grander scale and succeeding. He also was born in Africa. His mother is from Ghana and father from the Midwest. They met in the decade after independence on the campus of the University of Ghana. And Anim lived in Ghana, an exotic Nashville, and then Ivory Coast before settling back in D.C. when he was 11. In college, he studied astrophysics and history and then got a master's in public policy at Harvard. He then founded the Real Food Challenge, of which he's executive director. RFC's goal is to redirect $1 billion of college food purchases towards local, fair, and sustainable sources within 10 years, and it's working. He'll tell you that. He'll tell you about that. A little tiny bit of housekeeping, or just to tell you what we're going to do here. Sara is going to talk first. We haven't changed that, right, for probably 25 or 30 minutes, and then Anim for about the same length of time, and then we'll sit here and have a conversation which will leave us with enough time to take questions from you. So please join me in welcoming Sara, and we'll welcome Anim later.
Good evening. Can you all hear me? Yep. All right. Is this better if I use the podium mic? Okay. Well, it's such a pleasure. And first, I just want to thank you, Mark and Anim. It's just an incredible honor to be on the stage with you. We'll be on the stage with you to share this space and to be able to share this conversation. So I'm really looking forward to the discussion we're going to be having. And I also want to thank UC Berkeley, including Kathy DeMaster, who originally invited me into this, Gary Sposito, everyone at the Berkeley Food Institute for putting this class together and inviting all of us to be part of this discussion together. And I want to thank all of you, the students in this class, for your engagement, for your passion, for your enthusiasm for these issues, and also all the community members who've come here and who are watching on live stream or on video afterwards. I'm very conscious that there's a lot of wisdom and experience in this room and out there in the world that's connected to this, and I'm proud to be learning together with all of you. So today's talk is called With Liberty, Justice, and Food Sovereignty for All. And I was thinking about how one of my nieces, I have 11 nieces and nephews, and one of my nieces who's 15, after the killing of Trayvon Martin and Michael Brown and Eric Garner, she started asking, you know, is there really liberty and justice for all? And we talked about it, and I think, you know, both agreed there absolutely is not. Similarly, there is not currently food sovereignty for all. But that said, I think it's really important for us to talk about what it means. What does food sovereignty mean? How is it connected to liberty and justice for all?
What is the vision, and how are communities and social movements around the world and in the US struggling to achieve that vision? So I'm looking forward to talking with all of you also about what we can all do to stand in solidarity with those communities and movements so that together we can reach those goals. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about Grassroots International. I won't have to say too much because Mark did an excellent introduction. But just to let you know, Grassroots International was founded in 1983. We celebrated our 30th anniversary a couple years ago. And from the beginning, it's been about accompanying social movements that are working towards global justice, because we believe that change comes from the ground up. We started working in the Middle East and in East Africa, and currently we continue to do work in the Middle East as well as with movements in Haiti, Brazil, Mesoamerica, and some increasing work in West Africa and other parts of the world. And since the 2000s, we've had a focus on movements that are working for resource rights. So resource rights means rights to land, water, food sovereignty, and increasingly climate justice, how that's connected. So why these issues in particular? I mean, you all care about food. A lot of people in the world care about food. So we all eat, as a number of speakers have said, so it's very important. In addition to that, I think we've seen how corporations and elites around the world seeking to make profit are increasingly turning to land, water, food, seeds, the basic elements of life, to make more profit. There's a lot of people who've done an analysis of economic trends and seen how, you know, there's a lot of investment in the stock market, then there was a stock market crash and recession. A lot of investors moved into housing and real estate. And there was a housing bubble that burst. Land, water, seeds, the basic elements of life are becoming more and more valuable to people and to corporations because of things like climate change that are making these resources even more precious. And so we know that it's a real struggle for the survival and the well-being of large groups of humanity and many other species on this planet. And there's a lot at stake. So the decision to focus on the movements that are really working for resource rights is a strategic decision because we believe that that's what's going to be necessary for all of us. And so we're accompanying the social movements that are at the forefront of these struggles in the Global South. Leadership of women and youth within movements of small-scale farmers, peasants, indigenous peoples, Afro-descendant communities. And these are the movements that are most impacted by resource grabs. They're also the movements that have a clear and positive vision for the future and that have the experience and can build the power, along with allies, to make this vision a reality. So we form long-term partnerships with these movements, and they're based on shared values and vision, based on reciprocity, transparency, trust. We believe in getting resources to these movements because these are the movements that need the resources to do this kind of work. But it's also about political solidarity. It's about taking action together and raising consciousness towards our shared goals. And for that reason, we're also doing alliance building and advocacy work in the U.S. because we see ourselves as part of that struggle. So come back to that. Oh, that gave you I gave you a hint. So before I go on, I want to ask, how many of you have ever used the term food sovereignty before? Okay, so maybe a little less than half. That's great. How many people, the first time you heard of the term food sovereignty was related to this course, to edible education? So a few, maybe 10% or 25%. So it's a term that we've found is much more common internationally and is getting more and more recognition in the U.S. I learned about it, and Grassroots International learned about it from the movements that created the concept. So in 1996, there's an international social movement that I know some of you have talked about, and I believe Raj Patel talked about it in one of his talks. Can anybody say the name of this international movement of small-scale farmers and peasants? Yeah, exactly. Awesome. Via Campesina. So it's an international movement of over 250 million families of small-scale farmers, peasants, fisher folk, indigenous peoples, small food producers. That scale just boggles my mind, 250 million. And in the U.S., there are several members, including the National Family Farm Coalition, the Rural Coalition, and several farm worker groups, the Farm Workers Association of Florida, the Border Agricultural Workers Committee. So this is the organization that created the concept food sovereignty. And this is a picture of the members of Via Campesina taking action against the World Trade Organization. But they created that because as farmers, they knew firsthand the limitations of the concept of food security. So food security, at a most basic level, is about making sure that people have enough calories. They have enough food to eat to sustain their bodies. But what it doesn't take into account is what kind of food, where does the food come from, who grows it, under what conditions, what impact does that food system have on local communities and on the ecology. So in a nutshell, it's really about power. It's about who decides, who makes decisions about the food system. And food sovereignty is really about local communities making decisions about their own food systems in ways that are healthy for themselves, for people, for the planet. So this is a picture of an international forum on food sovereignty in 2007. So Via Campesina created the concept back in 1996. And in 2007, they called people together to have a conversation with other social movements, other groups outside of Via Campesina, because they said, you know, it's not just about one movement. We have to all work together to say, what does food sovereignty mean to you? How can we work towards it? How can we promote it? Does anyone know the name of this forum? Has anyone heard about it, 2007? Oh, World Social Forum is a wonderful guess, but it actually wasn't at the World Social Forum, although these concepts are very much alive in those discussions. This was the Nialeni Forum on Food Sovereignty. It took place in Selenge in Mali, named after a woman named Nialeni, who's a farmer. And at this forum, people came together and they came up with this definition of food sovereignty. So food sovereignty is the right of peoples to healthy and culturally appropriate food produced through ecologically sound and sustainable methods, and their right to define their own food and agriculture systems. It puts the aspirations and needs of those who produce, distribute, and consume food at the heart of food systems and policies rather than the demands of markets and corporations. So this is just a piece of the broader declaration. I definitely encourage folks to Google it and read the whole thing, but I think this captures a lot of the essence of what's really important. And La Via Campesina also has 7 principles of food sovereignty, so I wanted to share those with you as well. That it's a basic human right, as I know you've been talking about. 2 is that agrarian reform is critical. To be able to have food sovereignty, people need to have access to land and control over land, so redistribution of land and agrarian reform. Protecting natural resources, reorganizing food trade, right, so that communities can decide what kind of trade can happen, making sure that it's just and fair. Ending the globalization of hunger. This piece, social peace, so it's a recognition of the violence that communities face and the way that food and hunger is used as violence, but also that the ways that communities can create real social peace with women's rights at the center, and democratic control. So that's kind of the overall background. And also want to say it doesn't exist in a vacuum, that the food sovereignty movement is very clear about connections to other sectors, to other movements, from water rights. I know, you know, in California, you can't talk about food without talking about water. And that's true really all over the world. Trade justice, and I hope we'll be able to talk some about what's happening right now around trade. Economic justice. I know you've been having conversations about workers in the food system, farm workers, food chain workers, and that's so important to make sure that workers' rights are guaranteed. And I would say food sovereignty also deepens that to say, you know what, we actually need a fundamentally different economic system, that the current economic system of capitalism is not working. We can't have food sovereignty under it. We need to create new economic models, a lot of things around worker cooperatives, collective ownership and stewardship of land, of water, of seeds, things like that. Climate justice, racial justice, gender justice, all of these are part of a food sovereignty vision. So this is a little fun segue to the next part. One of my all-time favorite movies since I was little was The Wizard of Oz, and The Wiz more recently. And there's a couple of themes I want to draw on from that. So one is, I think, for food sovereignty movements and movements in general, we really need to make sure that we are using our brains. So that's the scarecrow. But we have to have our eyes open. We can't be fooled by interests that are trying to sell us false solutions. So I know you were talking in other classes about the Green Revolution. And this is one of the big things that has really been promoted as supposedly a solution to hunger, as supposedly a solution even to climate change. Their package of corporate seeds and pesticides, herbicides, and chemical fertilizers, you know, it's supposed to be this kind of magic combination. But we know that seeds that are part of that are out of farmers' control. We know that the pesticides and the herbicides are killing all forms of life that are really needed for a good biodiverse systems. We know that monocrops are also reducing biological diversity that we need to be resilient. We know that the chemical fertilizers are creating massive pollution. All of this contributes to climate change. So we really have to be using our heads and have a clear analysis of what the problems of this are. And it doesn't stop with the Green Revolution. There's newer incarnations. So how many people have heard about climate smart agriculture? Only a couple. So this is something new that's coming out from the UN with a lot of support from large-scale corporate interests that is supposed to be another magic pill, supposed to be another, you know, we need to address the drought and the flooding and all these conditions. And the way we're going to do that is with these packages of corporate seeds and pesticides and fertilizers and all of that. Sounds familiar. So a lot of people in social movements we're working with are saying this is a wolf in sheep's clothing. This is another example that just is carrying forward the message of the Green Revolution under a new name. So we need to be really clear about what the false solutions are, and then we need to talk about what we really want. What are the real solutions that are getting at the root causes of the injustices in the food system? And this is a diagram from our friends at the Movement Generation Justice and Ecology Project. Has anybody here heard of them? Awesome. So they're an awesome group actually located, based right here out of the Bay Area, Berkeley and Oakland, California. Definitely encourage you to check them out. I'm on their planning committees, to be transparent. But this is a diagram they put together to think about how to create a political strategy around real solutions. One of the difficulties is that sometimes people say, well, you have to do what's politically feasible. You have to focus on what's politically realistic. And so, you know, you can't go creating these big, huge demands for, well, we want to have free school food, free school lunches, and have all the farmers providing food for all of that. Or we can't have a completely community-controlled land or all of this, right? Has anybody heard people say that stuff like that is just not realistic? Yeah, so I think we hear that a lot. But actually, we know that what's politically realistic is not static. So if you look at this diagram, that's the circle in the middle. The false solutions, you know, often overlap with what's politically realistic because of a lot of the interests that keep them there. Ooh, okay. Cancel. Sorry about that. But actually, you know, there's a lot of real solutions. Some of them overlap with what's politically realistic. Some of them don't. But we can actually take action to change that. So, you know, we can move what we really need more into the realm of politically realistic and move out the false solutions from that realm. And the way that we do that is through grassroots organizing and through movement building. So that's why I think it's really helpful to just keep our eyes on the prize, to remember what we really want, and then take action and use strategies that will get us there. So this is a picture of a farm somewhere that, this could be a farm in a lot of different places. It's a beautiful, biodiverse, agroecological farm. Any guesses where this is? It's going to be hard to guess. This could be right here in Berkeley, right? Okay, how about with this picture? Does that give you a clue? Can anybody recognize those flags? Someone say something? Brazil. Brazil, yeah, absolutely. And do you know what's the name of this group? The MST. Absolutely, the MST, the Landless Workers Movement in Brazil. So this is one of our partners, one of the organizations. It's also part of Via Campesina. It's an international, it's internationally known social movement. And this is a picture of a land occupation where people were in really a standoff. People who were trying to take back land to farm on it and live on it and feed themselves and their families. And then you see the military. MST started 31 years ago, and it's been a real struggle, but they've had huge wins. It started by landless people who were living in favelas outside of cities in Brazil, and many of them had been pushed off their land by a lot of neoliberal economic forces, by large landholders, by corporate elites. But they knew that there was a lot of land that was in other people's hands and was not being used. So the Brazilian Constitution actually says that land that's not being used for other productive purposes, people can occupy it, and then if they produce on it, it can become theirs. That's a pretty amazing thing to have in the Constitution. So over the past 31 years, the MST has organized, and over 370,000 families have gained collective title to land through occupying it. And over 2,500 land occupations, so from, you know, several hundred to several thousand families. Together, they've won 7.5 million hectares of land that they've taken back for communities. So this is just staggering, that if you put all that land together, it's as big as the size of Massachusetts, where I live. So I think that just shows how much more is possible, that there really are movements that around the world are having an impact and getting to scale. And they're doing that by deep political education. They don't just go to the land and say, okay, we're just going to take it. They do a lot of work with people to analyze, okay, what's happening? What are our current conditions? What are the root causes? How can we overcome them? How can we prepare? So that's the brains. So what's another concept in The Wizard of Oz that you all know of, or The Wiz? Brains. What else? Heart. Yeah. So, and I know this was part of one of the other talks. I think also Raj Patel said we have to start from love, to start from who you care about, and go from there. And so that made me think about my own entry into this work, and it started with my own family. So, I want to recognize what my nephew, Lucas, who's 2 years old today, it's his birthday. Happy birthday, Lucas. And I got into this work after Hurricane Katrina, and my now almost eight-year-old nephew, Elias, was born. And my mother was holding him. She's holding him, you know, the way people hold babies. And she said, "What will this world be like for you 20 years from now?" And she's full of all this joy and wonder in her voice, imagining what the future might bring. And I was a wreck. I was a waterfall. I was deeply, deeply sad thinking about the future that my nieces and nephews, the people I love very dearly, are inheriting. And I was also, in addition to Katrina, was thinking about my family back home in Ethiopia and impacts of climate change there, drought and impacts on farmers. And so that was pretty tough. I think it's an important place to start. And that's what really made me think about the connection between climate justice and food sovereignty. This is a picture of the Stern Report, the Stern Review, which is a pretty mainstream report about the impacts of climate change. And it shows how basically, with less than 2 degrees centigrade of global warming, global temperature increase, agriculture systems in Africa are going to be devastated. And so that's also, like, that's people I love. It's people a lot of us love. And it made me think, you know what? reflecting on it over the past few months, I've actually thinking about how really food sovereignty and climate justice are very much about Black Lives Matter. Because who are the communities that are experiencing a lot of the first and most severe impacts of food injustices in the food system and of climate change? A lot of people throughout the African continent, a lot of communities of color in the US, Haiti, I mean, all over. But for me, starting from that place of love, that's where it took me to. And I think Michael Pollan talked about the connections between food and climate change with the percentage, and there's different percentages. This is a source from our allies at an international group called GRAIN that estimates that between 44 and 56% of greenhouse gas emissions come from the industrial agriculture system, taking into account a lot of different things, not only production, but also the land use change being one critical factor, transportation, and also processing, packaging, retail, waste. So that's the bad news, but it's also the good news, because it also shows us how much we can actually create solutions by addressing all of that. And so that's where a lot of the kind of joy of the heart for me came from. Does anybody know where this picture on the right is from? Any guesses? So this is from Cochabamba, Bolivia. So the multicolored flags in the background might give you a hint. Those are from indigenous communities throughout Bolivia. And I had a chance to go there in 2010 with a delegation of groups doing community organizing in the US. And that was the first place that I met people from La Villa Campesina. And they had these big, huge flags, like 3,000 of their members from all over the world. And it said, "Small farmers cool the planet." So that actually gave me a lot of hope. And I think it's not a coincidence that the slogan of La Villa Campesina is "Globalize the struggle, globalize hope." It's a positive vision of what is possible when small-scale farmers, food producers, communities come together that can really make huge changes. So that's another piece of the heart. This is also about home. So, Dorothy, what did she say? There's no place like home. And as our friends at Movement Generation say, eco means home. So ecological, economy, all of that has to do with the home. And I think of the planet as our home. So there's that connection between the food sovereignty and climate justice is also about our home and how to take care of it. And more we're seeing women's leadership growing. I know that was a conversation you've had as well. But I want to tell you about there's a group, a campaign of organizations in 5 countries in West Africa called We Are the Solution. And this is a group of rural women's associations in 5 countries that are working towards food sovereignty and agroecology as solutions to the both hunger and also climate impacts. And I also want to tell you about the Peasant Movement of Papay, which is an organization in Haiti, another one of our partners that has been around actually for 41 years. And they're making huge changes as well. They're very clear about how Haiti's particularly impacted by climate change. And they see their work on agroecology and food sovereignty as critical for the survival of the Haitian people. So they're actually showing, they're both fighting against the ways that they're being devastated by climate change, by industrial agriculture, by corporate interests. They're also creating a beautiful vision of what's possible. So they have established eco-villages in the Central Plateau in Haiti that combine the practices of agroforestry, which prevents erosion, that creates a lush habitat for many living things, and creates food sovereignty as well through planting fruit trees, so that contributes to food production. With organic vegetable production, with composting, with manure from the livestock, with water conservation strategies, it's a whole circle. And they're also achieving real scale. They have over 60,000 members, including 10,000 youth. They produce 300,000 fruit and forest trees a year. So this is a picture of one of their nurseries for the seedlings, for the trees that they go and plant. And they've done over 20 million fruit and forest trees since they started. Hundreds of community co-ops, you know, all of this together, it's really building the future we want to see. And all this together makes communities also resilient to climate impacts, while demonstrating a model of agriculture that restores ecosystems rather than devastating the planet. I haven't been there yet, but what others from grassroots have told me is that you can be driving in Haiti, and you know it's very deforested, that's a huge issue, but then you get to the areas where the MPP has been working, and all of a sudden it's lush and green and alive. And so I think that just shows the power of what social movements can do. Okay, so we talked about brains, we talked about heart, we talked about home. What's left? Courage, exactly. So this is a poster from just last Friday. And Friday was celebrated around the world, April 17th, as International Day of Peasant Struggle. And that's commemorating the date in 1996 when 19 people from the landless workers movement in Brazil were massacred, were killed for nonviolently defending their rights to land. And this is unfortunately a trend that we feel is increasing. From more and more of the social movements that we're working with, we're seeing increased militarization, increased repression, criminalization, and attacks on the people who are at the front lines, who are defending their rights to land, to water, to food sovereignty, and defending the planet. How many of you have read Naomi Klein's book, This Changes Everything? How many have heard about it? A lot, right? I would definitely encourage folks to read it. It's a really powerful book. And she talks about the ways that the increased crises that we are facing and we will continue to face are going to further polarize our world. She talks about how we're all going to have to choose about whether to let ourselves be driven by fear and hatred, which will lead to more repression and violence, or whether to operate from a place of love. And so I think reflecting on that, I feel like holding on to our humanity might be one of the biggest challenges that we're going to face as a species going forward. But the good news is so many people and communities around the world, even though they're facing such huge threats, are really proving that it is possible to hold on to humanity and to have courage in the face of a lot of repression. Okay. Technical problem. This is not doing anything. Well, we'll continue without the slides. What I wanted to tell you about next is actually Palestine. Oh, here we go. Maybe we're back. Oh, I think the program closed. Okay. We'll leave that. So last year, there were over 2,000 people who were killed in the bombings on Gaza. And you know, we have partners in Palestine and in the Middle East, so this is something that we were thinking about and feeling really heavy hearts. And hundreds of people, in addition to those who were killed, there were hundreds rounded up in the West Bank and put under administrative detention, expansion of illegal settlements, taking over lands also in the West Bank. But people there are continuing to resist. Continuing to say, you know what, this is our land, this is our territories, this is important to us as a people to stand up for, and we have no right to give up, even under really extreme conditions that I think a lot of us have a hard time just even imagining what that would be like. Small-scale farmers, farming communities were saying, you know what, we have to continue forward in the struggle. And that was really humbling for us. And we also heard from young women who are involved in social movements defending rights to land and water. They said, you know what, previous generations, they said, we will die for Palestine. But what we're saying is we will live for Palestine. So I just think that takes incredible courage and is incredibly inspiring, and I think a call to all of us that if they're not giving up, that we can't give up either. And Honduras is another place where we're seeing similar things. So there was a coup in 2009,
And after the coup, we've seen a lot of repression of movements defending their rights to land and territory. We've seen scores of peasants in the Bajawaguan region of Honduras who've been killed. We've seen Afro-descendant indigenous communities, Garifuna communities, who are coming under a lot of attacks, being displaced, kidnappings, etc. There's an office of our partner, Via Campesina, in Honduras that was actually shot up by machine gun fire just last month. So it's heavy. But at the same time, people are bringing a real dedication to the struggle and to the vision of food sovereignty and why that's so important. So I think that courage is something that we all can learn from. So to wrap up, I want to just segue to what that means in the U.S. context. And we've been talking about what's happening around the world because we think that's very important. We have a lot to learn from social movements around the world, around the concept of food sovereignty. But there's a lot happening here in the U.S. And I think two main things that we're seeing as important efforts. One is understanding and learning from the movement so that we can take action to address the impact of our own government or our corporations here around the world. So around trade, do people know what happened last week around the Trans-Pacific Partnership? Anybody know? Somebody say something? Folks are quiet. There was a bill introduced promote fast track, to allow fast track so that the TPP could be decided on without a really vigorous and robust or transparent process. And so we're calling on people to reach out and say, you know what, we have to stop fast track, and we also have to stop the Trans-Pacific Partnership. And there's so many groups that are doing so much work around this. I know Real Food Challenge is doing that, and a number of other folks. So that's one really critical area, because the impact of trade on agriculture, it can be a huge threat to communities' food sovereignty, both in the U.S. and around the world. So that, you can take climate, you can take so many other issues, but we need to work on that. We also need to be working on the injustices in the food system right here. I know you've talked about some of those, and I look forward to talking more with all of you about it. I think we're just about at time, so maybe I'll keep examples for the discussion. But I know that students are in a really important part of the solution, too. So I'm really looking forward to Anim's talk about the ways that students on campuses throughout the country are working towards a just food system. And one thing to just close out, back to the Wizard of Oz analogy. So the wizard, right, they found out that he's behind this curtain. And they went to him to try to get the courage and the heart and to go home and the brains. And what did they find out? They had it in themselves, right? So he couldn't give it to them. They had it in themselves. And I think that's really true for food sovereignty, that there is no one who says that they are the great and powerful Oz will be able to create food sovereignty for us. Mm-hmm. That really food sovereignty is about saving ourselves. It's about creating the new future that we want to see through our hands in the soil, through our feet on the streets, through our hearts and our minds together. So thank you very much. Let's see if we can figure out this technical issue for Anim.
Thank you, Sara. Sara. I want to start speaking, but this is a PC. I work on a Mac, and I'm afraid if I take my eyes away, I will not be able to recover. Let me start anyway by, if you're both still willing to help me, thank you so much. And thank you for your talk. It's really one of the reasons I was so excited to be here was to meet you after hearing about you for so long and to connect with your work. Really enjoyed it and felt inspired by it. And I want to also thank everyone, the organizers, Mark and Gary, and all the organizers, and Alice Waters for inviting me when we had a great conversation about exactly a year ago, really interesting dialogue. So I hope this will feed into that continual process of learning that we have that we've begun. I wanted to start with a story. And this story takes us all the way back to the 1780s, 1785 precisely. And it involves a young man named Thomas Clarkson, who's 26 years old. He's a scholarship student at Cambridge University in England. And he enters a Latin essay contest. So the Latin essay contests of that day were kind of like the Rhodes scholarships or Fulbright now. If you win one, everyone attaches it to your name from here on out. So very prestigious. And he's a conscientious student, so he enters it. And the topic that was chosen for that year was the question, is it lawful to make slaves of others against their will? So that was a provocative question. Of course, it was said in Latin, but I can't speak Latin. And he had to write it in Latin, which is the trick of it. But it's a provocative question at the time because it was a time when the entire world economy ran, such as it was, on slave labor. Or on forced labor in its entirety. And I don't mean every single place had that, but the large amounts of wealth that were being generated in England and in the Americas, the new American country at that time, much of it was coming from forced labor. And it was a time that it was infused into all parts of society, including universities. So here on this side of the Atlantic, when almost the same year that Clarkson was entering his contest, a gift was made to the fairly young Harvard University at the time to establish a law school. And the gift came from a family whose wealth came from plantations in the West Indies. So that's just one example of many of the earlier colleges in the United States who had that relationship with slavery. And anyway, he goes on, he writes the essay, he actually wins it. He's researched it very thoroughly, which is key to the story. And he reads the essay at the final thing he does as his prize. He reads it, and he rides off to London, where he is going to take a post as a deacon in the Church of England. It's very prestigious. And as he's riding away, he can't stop thinking about what he's learned. You know, he could be thinking about his great future, but he's obsessed with the horrors that he has just discovered, which have been so far hidden to him, just like most Britons. And he's so disturbed by it that he gets on and off his horse. He walks sometimes. And at one point, he just sits down by the side of the road holding his horse. And he says, later he said, a thought came to my mind that if the contents of the essay were true, it was time some person should see these calamities to their end. And Adam Hochschild, who writes about this in this book, this wonderful book that I love, called Bury the Chains, Prophets and Rebels in a Fight to Free an Empire's Slaves, says that if there was a moment that the anti-slavery movement became inevitable, it was that moment. Because it was Thomas Clarkson's, his young energy that brought the several people in the country together who were beginning to work against slavery and forged it into a movement which then involved tens and thousands, hundreds of thousands of people. So I share that with you because, and I would almost want to do a talk only about this, because everything is in here. It's the beginning of human rights campaigns. The Free Human Rights Campaign is a food movement campaign, in essence, a boycott of sugar. So there's so much. It also links with what Raj Patel said in his earlier lecture. He made an allusion to the Haitian Revolution. And so in this book is a vivid description of the rebellion in Saint-Dominique of slaves. So I really recommend it as kind of should be part of the canon of books about the food movement and the origins of both food injustice and the movement. But I bring it up here really is to say to talk about the role of universities, that universities can either be perpetuators and participate and perpetuate injustice, including food injustice, or they can be places where people question and confront injustice. And with that frame, I want to turn now back to us, kind of zoom into our day, And in particular, look at the role of dining services it's a message about the Trans-Pacific Partnership as it happens. It's been a long week, but we'll come back to that. So we want to look at University Day and the dining services in particular, and I just want to use our experience in the Real Food Challenge campaign to identify some principles of how we can go about building a powerful movement, and doing that with an eye towards like I said, bringing it home, and thinking about the challenges that Sara and others have talked about, the enormous challenges, heavy challenges facing us. Coming back to the question which I've heard from this class before, which is what can we do? So I'm actually going to skip over some of what I thought I might say about the different ways in which universities have been a part of the food system and food injustice in particular. I don't know if it'll come up again. I'm going to just go right into one of, I think, the most personal and intimate ways, and maybe powerful ways that we participate in the food system, which is by the act of eating in dining halls and associated dining services in our cafeterias. It's in this, in this act where we are intimately connected with the farmers in this country, the small farmers, other farmers abroad, and also with the issues that they represent. Earlier in this class, we've talked about sexual harassment in the strawberry fields, and we've talked about the struggle of farmers, fisher folk, and ranchers all over. So we're connected when we eat to those struggles and to those joys. So there are over 4,000 institutions of higher education in this country. Not all of them, but many of them have residential operations and cafeterias. And I think the first thing I would say about college dining is that it is made up of really many wonderful people, many of whom I've got a chance to meet, who really care about the very hard job of feeding students, feeding them safely and beautifully. And I've really found that to be true at all levels of organization, from managers to line cooks. And I think it's, they all deserve our gratitude, and it's a shame that gratitude is not always paid by or repaid by wages which honor that work. As you know, I think it's been covered before that 7 of the 10 lowest-paying jobs in this country are in food service, and many folks working in the cafeteria represent a disproportionate number of people who are on food stamps themselves and who are food insecure. So we have to recognize that. The other thing I need to say is that food service or dining halls is big business. Here is a look at that, and a comparison. Dining services in the country altogether represented about $19 billion in sales. How does that stack up to other things? Well, it's much larger than all but the largest fast food operations. And it takes at $5 billion, schools spend all $5 billion altogether to feed their students by buying food ingredients. So it is big business. The third thing I want to say about college dining is that it exemplifies two trends in the food economy that I would highlight right now. The first is an increase in what the Economic Research Service at the USDA calls food away from home. So you can see that this is a chart stretching from 1963 to 2008. And that the percentage of food, the dollars that consumers spend in the economy on establishments, not at home, so not going to the grocery store and preparing at home, has steadily risen. And now, this chart was made, it's pretty much at parity. I raise this to say, first of all, to say technically that this is what that collection of eateries and cafeterias and stadium food and et cetera is called, and restaurants is is that's called the food service industry. That's a term I'll use quite frequently. This other thing is to say that if we're going to think about changing the food system, we really have to think also about changing food service. It's not just about, we can't just talk about farmers markets and grocery stores and gardens. Those are important, but we need to have this balance as well. So the other trend that this exemplifies is the corporatization and concentration in the food industry. There are two ways that universities can operate their dining services. One is by running it themselves, which was more common in the past. The other is by outsourcing it, by having a contract with a company who specializes in that to run it for them. Over time, this practice has grown so that most colleges and universities in the country now outsource their operations. And most of those operations that are outsourced or contracted are run by three big companies, Aramark, Compass Group, and Sodexo. And Compass Group operates several subsidiaries. So I'm going very fast, by the way, because usually when we talk about this, we do this, we have several hours of workshops to understand the food economy. So pardon me if it's too fast, but I think I'm getting a little bit of comprehension off faces. A few nods here and there. We can always go back. Okay, so I'll keep going. So this concentration is a trend. And just to get a sense of these companies, because I think most of us don't really hear about these companies, they're not public or consumer-facing like many other ones, we don't really have a good sense of them. But considered globally, as multinational companies that they are enormous. The biggest of them, Compass Group, which is a UK-based group, with $25.6 billion in revenues globally, is about as big as McDonald's globally. And you know what happens if McDonald's says they want a certain kind of potato. The market moves for McDonald's. So I say this to think this is a really important a lever that we might have to create change down the supply chain. So let me say, so one of the consequences of this concentration is as follows. And again, this is one of those things that I'm gonna try to do it fast and simplify it as much as possible, but it's a fairly complicated thing. But let's give it a try. So one of the consequences is the increase in a practice that is in the industry known as volume rebates or volume discounts. We're stepping back away from that for a second. If you think about my idea of what, before I started this work, what a economic relationship might be, would be the university pays a food company for food, which gets delivered to it, right? That does happen. Now, when you throw the corporate food service in the mix, this is what it looks like. And again, this is simpler than we would normally draw it, but it still gets at the idea that now dollars are flowing to a food service company headquarters far away from the local manager. There's someone on site who's running it, and it is then that food service company is working or contracting with big food companies through distributors to acquire food to the university. And what is happening is that those deals are increasingly being sweetened by rebates or discounts. It's the same kind of thing you get if you buy a printer. I always forget to send mine in. I lose $50. But in this case, they are not forgetting to send it in, and they are paying what, in other terms, would be called a kickback. Right? For the privilege of doing business, there is this relationship. What's really important to know right now is that. It's not, when we first started and we learned about this, I think we understood it as a deal sweetener. Increasingly, it is the business. That's because the rebates that come back are almost pure profit. And for the most part, they stay with the food service company. So again, let me give an example. Like Aramark is a food service company. They have a deal with Tyson for chicken. And if they buy a certain amount, they will get a check that based on the volume that they buy. And so, So this so it's a deal between a company headquarters and the and Tyson, and for the most part, though not always, it really stays with the company. It doesn't flow back to the university. Again, there's lots of nuances here, but that's the general rule. And then we should also, let's see if I got this right. Nope. Okay. And then part of the deal with this is that there are preferred vendor status. In exchange for these rebates, it's an exclusive relationship. And at the local level, the managers are really told to comply with that. Maybe 90% of your purchases must come through preferred vendor arrangements like that. So what is this? Why is this important? Well, if you care about mid-sized farmers or small food companies, either in this country or abroad, who are, particularly for mid-sized farmers, who are the ones who are being most squeezed out of the market, you should be very concerned about this. Because it is the companies that can pay the biggest rebates which are getting the most business. And the bigger the companies, the more concentrated the food service corporate companies are, and the more concentrated the food companies are, the vendors, the more this becomes important. So the cycle perpetuates, and I would suggest this is one of the market structures that Stephen Gleisman talked about in an earlier lecture that make things difficult for many, many producers. Is that okay? All right. So that brings me to the real point I think I want to make, which is the importance of thinking about, maybe even obsessing about, power. That if we don't bring power more and more into our conversations as a grassroots movement attempting to change big conditions and injustices, then we may miss the mark. And the question of power is, you could say it's the, you're asking what are the underlying power dynamics of the situation, and how do we build power together to change the situation? Martin Luther King, if you're thinking about this as I am increasingly, and by the way, it's something I remember hearing several times in some of the lectures I saw, including in the very moving session about farm workers, right? So power is a question that we look at both in the fields, but also in the kind of the industry and the economy. So Martin Luther King was one of the people who thought a lot about power, and I always found this interesting that towards the end of his life, right? He didn't know it was at the end of his life. He thought he was at a stage of the movement, which was stretching for the next thing. And in the point of reflection, he said, "Our nettlesome task today is to discover how to organize the strength into compelling power so that the government cannot elude our demands." Fascinating to me. I think, what? They did so much, and yet he felt that they hadn't achieved power. And there's a lot in there. I'll leave that as a question to reflect on. Why did he not feel that they had power? So let me now turn to the real food challenge and how we think about power. And in particular, what I just want to do is just talk about four principles in the process of that we have discovered in creating change and building power together. I've gotten ahead of myself. I'll be there in just one second. So the change. I should be clear about what we are. There we go. Back again. What are we trying to change? So the Real Food Challenge was launched in 2008 as a coalition of students and faculty and dining service professionals and organizations. And the idea was to harness the buying power of universities and the political power of youth students to create change through that whole supply chain. And the goal that we had, those of us who co-founded it were inspired by different people. I was personally heavily inspired by Anna LaPay, who had done a lot of thinking about the importance of procurement in universities, like in the sweatshop, anti-sweatshop movement. So the goal at the time was to shift $1 billion. This is what we said. Could we shift $1 billion of college food budgets, which would be about, if you remember, about 20% or about a fifth of the total, to real food by 2020? And what we came to define as real food was local and community-based, fair, so fair trade, domestic fair trade, cooperatives, et cetera, ecologically sound and or humane. Again, so the idea was we were going to try to divest, in effect, like divest school budgets from industrial agriculture and shift it to a real food economy as quickly as we could. And I'm getting ahead again. Okay, but I should get there because so the first principle I'll highlight, and I'm going to do these quickly as well so we have as much time as possible for talking, is power, is the first one is power and leverage, power mapping and leverage. There are a lot of great examples I'd love to, or a few that I would have liked to cite. Actually, I'll just do this one with a coalition of Immokalee workers. The ability to have a sharp analysis, sophisticated analysis, and to direct your action is one of the key turning points in many movements and campaigns. So I'll refer back to the Eric Schlosser talking about the coalition of Immokalee workers, who had for years worked to change the conditions, and it was only when they redrew their power map were they able to speed towards victory. Same for Alice Paul and the women's suffrage movement 100 years ago, changing tactics and by changing the power map. In our case, the way that we looked at leverage was by understanding that the college market is really just a slice of the entire, not a big slice of the entire food system, the food economy, which is $1 trillion. But it's a particularly profitable and competitive one. So those companies that we were talking about compete like crazy for contracts which could be tens of millions of dollars a year and last for 5 to 10 years. And it's a captive audience. Very few businesses have such a devoted and steady source of income that they know ahead of time. So no wonder that they really compete for it. So that leverage and the fact that those companies are linked to other ones, like distributors throughout the food system, means that if we can make change here, we can set a pace for change throughout. So that was our version of leverage. And what's been really important is to have make public commitments, to have universities make public commitments to real food. So by signing on to our Real Foods Campus commitment, for instance, and that by doing it publicly and in a uniform way, it focuses the attention of the industry and the companies on the fact that a change is happening. And so even if they're looking at a self-operated school, right, one that runs their own dining hall that is not contracted, and they see that they made a commitment and they ever want to get that business, they understand they have to begin to change their practices. And so to date, we've had over 60 universities make those commitments. Most recently, the University of Pittsburgh and University of Utah. And altogether, we've committed, now students have worked to shift $65 million towards real food sources. The second principle is transparency and accountability. And in this case, the real food calculator, but transparency and accountability or information, who has information and who has the ability to monitor promises that are made is a critical element of who has power and shifting power dynamics. So we have had, we've created a calculator, a set of criteria and a way of measuring that students at over 100 universities in this country are using to audit their own and assess their own dining services and to share that information more publicly. I'm going to go quickly, so this is our, we're testing and testing out as an online tool. And it allows us to do things like this, to show the percentage of real food. I'm going to go quickly through this. These are calculated to the kind of things we can see at a university from year to year that help us break down really precisely where is that food coming from. So, but I'll go quickly because I want to get to other things. So the other thing I mentioned about transparency and accountability is this picture, which is not a great photo at all, but I love what's behind it, which is it's a meeting at UMass Amherst, and it's over 100 students and community members showed up to discuss how they were going to spend the $4.6 million each year that they had decided to spend on real food. One of the questions that came up there was, do we want just any fair trade bananas, or do we want ones that are specifically from small farmers and not from plantation And students did research there to come up with an answer and present it to others. So the other principle, the third I would bring up, is solidarity and allyship. Again, whole workshop on this and much more in a lifelong of learning. But this is really about, for us, being in relationship, and the kind of relationship that I kind of feel like Steve Gleason talked about, in relationship with producers and those we are trying to affect, because it is their direction and their knowledge which needs to guide our work. And so one example of this is the fish camp we had last year in Boston with students from seven universities who got together with fisher folk from the Northwest Atlantic Marine Alliance and from processing plant workers. And what we're trying to do there is to really understand, do the criteria, the labels around seafood that exist actually serve small boat fishermen well? Do we need to adjust our own criteria, learning from them? And how can we support them on their policy battles as they struggle to stay on the water? And are there species of fish which are not often utilized and often can be thrown away that we could actually use in the dining hall and create income for them and also awareness for students? The last principle I'll mention is process and evolution. This is about understanding that building power is something that happens over time, and it's I'll refer to the diagram. Marshall Gans, who was an organizer with, he left university, Harvard University, to join Cesar Chavez, and he does a lot of work about grassroots movements. Observed that the social movements, grassroots movements, don't have at the beginning the resources that they will need for the big fights, kind of towards the end. And that is a process of building that and hopefully timing it with peaks of intensity over time. And resources can mean dollars and funds. It can mean supporters and people. And I think it can also mean moral authority and moral clarity. And I've been thinking a lot more about this. This is kind of a new thought. But I sense that the moral clarity that that I think this movement and the climate justice movement, other movements, and food sovereignty movements have started with, is itself growing. The moral clarity to say no to more drilling, to say we have to keep the oil in the ground, to say no to development, to occupy the farm, right, as in the Gill Tract. I think that that moral clarity, which communities that have long suffered and fought against extractive industries, in which agriculture today is largely one, that is spreading and growing, and in particular amongst younger people. So I also leave that as a question to consider. So I'll close now just by coming back to a thought about power and the theme that Sara brought up and others. About love, because I think power and love actually really do connect. And so we'll end with a quote from Martin Luther King, one of my favorites. Actually, we won't end with that. part of the process of, that's called suspense. part of the way that we build, we join people together and go from a movement of just a room of six people to 100,000 students participating in some way in Real Food Challenges to use this Real Food Wheel, which allows everyone to say what is their interest, why did they come to this work, and identify where on the wheel they are and see how it fits into the whole. So that's a graphic we use. So back to where I'll end. Martin Luther King observed that power without love is reckless and abusive, and love without power is sentimental and anemic. Power at its best is love implementing the demands of justice, and justice at its best is power correcting everything that stands against love. Thank you.
Okay. I wonder if we should talk about the Trans-Pacific Partnership, but it'll probably come up. To me, what ties everything we're all doing together is justice and movements, and you both travel a lot, and you talk about this all the time, and I guess the question is if we can realistically appraise where the food movement is at in the United States and globally. And that's something that each of you can, because I think we'd agree that, you went past your really good looking wheel very quickly. I'm sure all of you absorbed it, but I was, I would guess that the gist is no matter what aspect of food or justice you care about, your goal is, at the end of the day, pretty much the same. The question is, how can we be hopeful? What should we be doing? The questions are, how can we be hopeful? What should we be doing? What direction are we best going in? Sara, you've had a break, so we'll give Anim a break.
Give you a little bit.
Sure, I might take
some water.
Some
water,
start.
Sure.
Bottle up. Thank you so much.
You're welcome. And we have the oranges here if you want
one. Yeah, I can't eat and think at the same time.
Okay. I think that's absolutely the question. So thank you for opening with that. I think what we're seeing is that there's a ton of momentum that's been building. There's, globally, I think the movements around food and food sovereignty in particular have really gotten to scale in ways that we dream of happening in the U.S., but I think there's also a lot happening here. So maybe I'll start with that and then go back to the global. What we're seeing in the U.S., so we're excited to be in an alliance called the U.S. Food Sovereignty Alliance. I think there's some people here who are familiar and have been connected to that, Anna LaPay, among others. And it's an alliance of groups that are including small-scale farmers, including farm workers, including food justice groups organizing in urban areas and indigenous groups, too. And we've been trying to learn over the past 5 years since that alliance has existed about what are some of the major successes and kind of ways forward. I think we've seen a lot of successes at a local level. So, for example, in Maine, there's groups that have won what they're calling food sovereignty ordinances at, in their own local town, saying that farmers have a right to grow food in the way that it makes most sense for them, and rather than being kind of tied up by regulations that prevent them from selling raw milk, for example, or things like that, and selling directly to consumers. So that's something that I think a lot of people are looking at. I think in places like Detroit and in Boston, there's huge movements of communities, including African American communities of color, low-income communities that have been taking over land that's been left vacant for years and turning that into community farms and gardens. And actually, there's a group of folks in Boston that when they visited Detroit at the U.S. Social Forum, a group called Alternatives for Community and Environment, came back and said, you know what, we have to start taking back land in our own communities, and they call it Grow or Die. There's a group called the Urban Farming Institute, which is taking over, which is doing a lot of training of local farmers. So I think we're seeing a lot of exciting things like that. Indigenous communities from Bemidji, Minnesota to Black Mesa, Arizona, I think are really organizing around both in Black Mesa, they've passed tribal resolutions against GMOs and for food sovereignty and seed sovereignty. So that's a really important step at a local level. They're also organizing their own community seed exchanges and taking back what they call traditional life ways the ways that indigenous peoples in Arizona have traditionally farmed to conserve water, to preserve the kinds of species of seeds that are really important to them and the stories that go along with them. So I think we're seeing a lot of exciting examples like that. Farm workers who've been organizing, you know, all over the country, but a few examples, community to community in Washington State that's been organizing farm workers. There's a boycott around the Sukuma Farms that's been gaining more attention nationally. And they're also, in addition to fighting the bad, trying to build the what they want. And so they and the Farm Workers Association of Florida have been saying, let's create our own community farms and community gardens so that farm workers are not only working for other people, but maybe we can actually work for ourselves. Maybe we can control our own food production, and seeing that as another step. So I think there's a lot of exciting examples, even right here in the Bay. You mentioned Occupy the Farm. Also, I know there's a group in San Francisco called People Organizing to Defend Environmental and Economic Rights that's been doing a lot around local food and community gardens and taking back community space. Urban Tilth is a group in Richmond, California that's been doing really great work with youth organizing around food. So I feel like we have a lot of exciting models happening at the local level, and there's efforts to try to connect them more to one another. That's one of the things I think the U.S. Food Sovereignty Alliance is trying to do. There's a Climate Justice Alliance that we're also part of that has community groups most impacted by climate change around the country and are looking now at what's a national platform we could have around food justice and food sovereignty. So I think there's a lot of momentum building on that, and you know, I think the challenges are how do we take the local examples and then build up so that people have more power collectively so we can both learn from what people have been doing locally but also put out a national vision and strategy. And I think you've been having some conversations, which I think would be great to talk more about related to HEAL and things like that. But yeah, that's some of what I've been seeing here. And you know, I think there's also broader, what you'd call broader food movements, not just food sovereignty or food justice, but obviously people all over who've been just caring more about food and looking into where does it come from and how do we make decisions about that, that I think we're trying to find more and more ways to link the frontline impacted community struggles to that broader interest or vice versa. And then globally, you know, we're seeing definitely a lot of steps forward and also steps back, right? So for a while, the WTO people said, well, it's not dead, but it's in the fridge. It's like kind of cool. And then, you know, it's kind of made a comeback. And I think people are trying to step up and say, you know, how can we build enough power so that we can challenge that across sectors of movements, not only food, but working with folks who work around migration, working with folks who are talking more about climate justice, working with workers' rights. You know, these are issues that are not new, but I think there's an increasing recognition of the need for different sectors of movements to work together. And through the World Social Forum process and other processes, we are seeing more of that movement building, but I think we have a lot more work to do. So, you want to pick up from there?
Yeah, there's several years ago, the Kellogg Foundation did a study. They asked the question, at what percent of the U.S. food economy could you consider, or food that is eaten by people in the U.S., could be considered basically, you know, healthy, not fair, not exploitative, somewhat sustainable and affordable. And in their research, they came up with the answer that it's about 2%, which means that the typical American, anyway, is eating meals that have a hidden cost one way or the other. So I use that as a what you asked, how, where are we? So just in terms of I mean, we're at a, and I don't think it's changed that much when what we see from universities that we understand. So we have a long way to go to change that. I think we're just in some ways at the beginning, but at a really promising place. One of the things that I think is promising when we talk about how do we bring the different sectors who have not, or even just different movements that have not even totally seen themselves as this part of the same movement together, is the fact that food chain workers are much more organized together and in relationship to the rest of the food movement than they were. And that's largely through their own effort to kind of yank the food movement and say, hey, we are a part of it too. And so I think that creates a whole other political possibility, because when 20 million, the largest segment of workers in the economy are seen as and maybe begin to be part of this, we have a different kind of political possibility. And as Sara mentioned, we're my organization and Union of Concerned Scientists and Food Chain Workers Alliance and Movement Strategy Center and others are working to try to create the coalition that can set an agenda and live up to the kind of food plan that you called for, Mark, and others. Like, how can we actually create that platform?
I don't want to be a downer, but there's a lot of room for industrial food to expand. I mean, we think of industrial food as dominant, and indeed in the United States it is. But in fact, food sovereignty is quite real around the world, as you've seen better than I have. But I think something like 70% of the world's food is still produced in traditional ways, using disproportionately small amounts of, I think the numbers are 70% of the world's food is produced using 30% of its resources, agricultural mm-hmm. resources, and 30% of the world's food, industrial food, is produced using 70% of the. Okay. So really when you look at it, there's a lot of room for industrial agriculture to grow.
Absolutely.
And there's a way in which that growth is better poised than the food movement is to make things happen. Mm-hmm. There's real reason to be hopeful, but there's also real reason to be scared to death.
Absolutely.
And I raise this because of the Trans-Pacific Partnership in some part, and because my experience in the last few months, but especially in the last couple of weeks since the fast track legislation was introduced last week, and again, this is legislation that would allow President Obama to essentially force Congress to vote yes or no on what's called Trans-Pacific Partnership, which is ostensibly a trade agreement, but is really a license for international capital to move however it wants and move food and labor pretty much however it wants. I could go on, but this isn't about what I know. This is about what you know. Sorry. I find this really scary.
Yeah.
I find that many people, like my friends, who I think are pretty smart people, don't know anything about any of this. So what I think what we're seeing is a real, I think you can argue that there's a food movement, and I think you can argue that we've made a dent and that there's reason for industrial agriculture, the big food, to be nervous, but I see this kind of thing as a counterattack. Mm-hmm. So are we really prepared for this and what can happen? And maybe this isn't so much a food question as a political question, but we know that this is coming down to power and politics, as you've just said. So let's just tackle that for a few minutes, and then we'll hopefully get questions from people in the audience.
I'm terrified too, sure. I think, and to be clear, because WTO, NAFTA, trade deals are think are so like arcane and hard to understand. And this one is secret, not by, we don't, most of us don't know about it, not by accident partly, but partly because it's being conducted in secret. So we're not necessarily meant to know about it. It's scary from this point of view because it creates a court. One of the ways it operates is it creates a special court in which a company or a country can sue another company, I mean, sue another country for anything, for something that impedes its profits. And so if you are a city that says, passes an ordinance that says you want to actually purchase 20% of your food from around the area, that could be eligible for legal action under this, or organic labeling, or fair trade labeling, or you know, all sorts of ways that we direct ourselves.
So or it's a bad. Soda tax.
Or a soda tax. Mexico was sued by Cargill for having a high fructose a tax on high fructose corn syrup. So it's a direct threat to what we're trying to do. But to your question, the one thing that gives me hope is that these have been stopped before. And that's why we spent all last week rallying students, got 100 students on a webinar, made phone calls on Friday. You can still do this. Citizens Trade Campaign, by the way, is a place to go. You can easily make calls to your representatives. So in some ways, I'm using this to say, like, not to theorize, but say, like, we have to get busy right now and stop this. And we can do it. And if we do it, well, I'll stop there.
Agreed.
Yeah, no, absolutely, and I share the terrifying feeling because I think what you brought up is absolutely true, that there's huge threats to the way that communities around the world have been producing food in ways that are much healthier. And you know, the Trans-Pacific Partnership, I think, is one really important example of that. You know, what we were talking about before when I brought up the Green Revolution, but also climate smart agriculture. We're seeing a lot of focus on Africa right now. There's this thing called the G8 New Alliance for Food Security and Nutrition. It's another way that governments that are kind of the rich and powerful governments are trying to pressure the governments of the global south to create what they call an enabling business environment. It sounds familiar. It's what free trade is trying to do as well, but this is one more mechanism. So they're creating country agreements with individual nations in Africa, and they're trying to get places that have passed really progressive legislation, such as legislation around protecting the seeds, you know, and preventing GMOs or protecting farmers' rights to share seeds. They're trying to get rid of that legislation to make way for corporations to come in and take over. Or land grabs. We're seeing more and more pushes for what they call foreign investment in land, but really what they're talking about is taking that land away from the local communities. And also changing protections on trade. So, you know, they're being very bold about it, and we're seeing that the impacts on communities on the ground are really severe. So there is reason to be terrified. And at the same time, you know, I think when I hear folks from Via Campesina say, you know, globalize the struggle, globalize hope, it's not empty. So in Mexico, there was actually a success in stopping the commercial planting of GMO corn because of social movements who fought for over a decade to do that. It's not a permanent win. There's still going to be continued struggles. But, you know, that's where corn is from. It's so important to local communities. That's a win that a lot of people thought wouldn't be possible. In Guatemala as well, peasant movements were able to defeat what's called a Monsanto law, which is another law that was trying to promote privatization of seeds. So I think, you know, is it at the level where it needs to be? Are we, like, on par in terms of power with the corporate interests that are trying to take over? Not yet, you know, and so that is scary. But when you think about the scale, like, wow, 250 million families, each family has, you know, probably four or five people, like, that's probably at least a billion people in one international network. And imagine all the other people who aren't in that one but are, you know, engaged in other ways. So that's what makes me feel like, okay, we're gonna be experiencing more and more difficult situations like we probably can't even imagine. But we also have a lot of the power within us to be able to find ways to overcome them, if not at the biggest levels, that at least on the ground where people are living. So that's where we're getting our inspiration and hope from.
Questions? That was very fast.
I've been thinking about it. Hi, so my question is a two-part question. The first part is, what exactly does the term fair mean when applied to food? I know that the term sustainable gets manipulated, what's in the marketplace, and it's really confusing. So my first question is, what does fair mean? And my second question is, how can we as students or simply citizens not only buy, but feel empowered to buy fair or ethically sourced food in a climate, as Alice Waters discussed last week, that is saturated with fast food values?
I can say really, maybe in the interest of time, I can say quickly that our the website that I showed you before, which is can be accessed from realfoodchallenge.org, lists our criteria for what we count as fair. Because there is there's the kind of heart and definition that people are honored and fairly compensated for their work. There's also, well, how do we exactly count that? So that's on our website. And things like a fair trade certification or domestic fair trade or being a cooperative are part of it. And then do you want to answer that part? and then as far as students, how can we direct our, say it again? This is not, I think, going to satisfy, and I want to leave room for other ones. But increasingly, I want to think about going from the I to the we. And that's why I think it's so important to do things in institutions. In some ways, it takes, you should always live up to your values. But there's incredible power in these aggregates of tens of thousands of people. And I think I would put a lot of effort into changing that, because you change it for so many people. But it's only a partial answer.
How's Real Food Challenge done at University of California?
University of California was one of our early successes. It was we were started at about the same time the students at UC were in their campaign, and so it actually, what's interesting is that a commitment was made back in 2010 to source 20%. What wasn't called real food, but it was kind of aligned with the standards that we had, and that it's so it was made back then. Since then, we've actually learned a lot more about how to really define it and how to have accountability. And overall, the UCs are doing well, I would say. But their newer universities that sign on have kind of more well-defined way of participating, is what I would say. But UC Santa Cruz signed the commitment a couple years ago at 40%, meaning that they're going to shoot for 40% real food by 2020. And students are really critical in helping fulfill that. They're implementing right now. Mm-hmm. And that's just one of the lead schools, I think, that others are learning from.
We have a sort of a related question from social media. What are some of the biggest hurdles universities face when switching to a real food system, besides the kickbacks among middlemen?
In some ways, I just want to say that's the more I learn, the bigger that is. I'll again, leave room for others. Maybe I'll just quickly say that cost is not as big an issue as I thought it was when I started this. Maybe there's a parallel to agroecology, actually, that there's that the more chefs and those who work in dining services can work with a diversity of food and not be restricted to a very kind of mono-type business model, the more they can balance costs. You know, one thing costs more, so they substitute it, you know, they substitute something else that costs less here and there. I think, and maybe Alice will be able to confirm if that is the, I think if you let chefs be chefs, they can manage costs. And we've had schools that switched from a contracted to self-operated. Budget's the same. Their real food percentage went up because the business model changed. So it's not as it's a big thing. It's an important thing. Not as big as I thought it was. I'll leave it at that.
Okay. Well, Mark actually started to ask the question that I was going to ask, which was exactly this, about bringing it home to Cal Dining. And I'm going to challenge you. I think some of the claims being made are quite a long ways away from the reality that's observable. I eat at Cal Dining. Probably many of the students here do. I also have the benefit of being a chef, and so I can decode their purchasing decisions just by observation. I can see what they're buying. What I see is we're buying stuff like organic lettuce that's readily available and all over the market, and then claiming to buy organic produce where the majority of the produce is not anywhere near that. The majority of the food products are not anywhere near anything that would represent a, you know, General Mills cake mix and things like this that aren't. And so I would challenge. I think we're the UC, and especially here at Cal Dining, is pathetically behind, almost to the point where it's crossed my mind if we shouldn't organize some sort of protest movement to get over there and demand that they do a better job for the students and for the workers. And I wanted to see what you thought of that. In particular, I'll ask a pointed question, is if we had a sustainable, the values implemented into that system, I would think one of the things that would occur is that the dining hall would become an expression for that nourishing and not a profit center. And so one of the first things I would like to look at and know is, does the dining centers, do they generate revenue for the university that's going into the treasury and other things, or do they spend 100% of the money, is it a break-even thing where they spend 100% of the money that I pay for a meal plan on the food, or is the university subsidizing the food service operation? Is what I pay less than the actual cost?
I don't know the specific situation here in that, especially financially, and it differs at universities tremendously. I would say I think your question is just beautiful in and of itself, and it's the kind of challenge that needs to be incorporated into continual dialogue and working groups between students and the community and the university. And that's part of, in our later iteration of our policy, we realized we have to put that in so that people could say that kind of comment. And just winning a policy is just the beginning. So implementation is the hard part. So I applaud your question.
Can I just, myself think this is really important, and I bet someone in that row there could answer that question more accurate, with more precision, or no? Anyone? Okay, sorry. I thought someone might know that. Well, Nina?
We're still researching, but the Cal Dining, you mentioned the procurement side, but on the labor side, right now all the employees are University of California employees. They're paid definitely living wages with pension and all the UC benefits. But as was announced a few weeks ago, the university is now proposing to shift it to private vendors. And there's nobody really understands, but there's a very major shift happening right now at this university in terms of who controls the dining services. So if anyone here knows more about it, we're all trying to understand it together.
Well, I can't say that I know more about it, but I'm wondering about one other thing that you may have discovered in your work. Is that when it comes right down to it, these food companies have connections to the university in lots of different ways. And when the president of the university has to make a decision, there's pressure put on him because they will withdraw money from another project he has if you don't keep the same vendor who is connected to that donor. And that's what we found happening at some of the universities on the East Coast. Did you find the same?
I'll say in general, yes, with lots of nuance. It's amazing, yeah, there's so much complexity in the arrangements.
You have to decide whether you're going to have a new building built. You know, you're really making the decision, are you having that new building, or are you letting sort of Coke stay there? Hard decisions.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
I actually have something to add.
Please.
Was talking with Alice earlier about this. I think there's a really good international connection, which is that we've seen this question of where schools are sourcing their food from, and is it sustainable and just and all of that. Some real successes and lessons from some of the movements working internationally. So in Brazil, some of our partners were working with both the landless workers movement and the popular peasant movement. They've won legislation that says that schools have to purchase at least 30%. So 40% would be amazing, but at least 30% of their food from local farmers. And those local farmers are organized. So I think that's another question is, how does the food get sourced? And how do the farmers that it gets sourced from, how are they building their power collectively? And so that way, they're building from the settlements where landless people have occupied and taken over and been able to produce food in a healthy way as a group, and creating new economic systems along with it. So I think there's some really exciting connections internationally, and I think also really exciting things to learn from the work that you've been doing.
And the more relationships we have between producers and students, university side,
absolutely.
I think the smarter we can and more ethical we can all be. So that's the direction
absolutely.
We want to go in.
And actually, you mentioned the Northwest Atlantic Marine Alliance. So they're part of the National Family Farm Coalition, which is part of Via Campesina internationally. So there's all these connections. Great.
Time for a couple more questions.
Currently, the Real Food Challenge has achieved under 10% of its goal, from what you're saying, of $1 billion removed from the, moved into real food. And I'm wondering how realistic you feel like it is to achieve your goal of $1 billion by 2020, and what you feel like you need in order to achieve that goal.
Is it realistic? Well, I know the direction we have to go in, which we're already going in, which is to kind of go to scale, and that's by doing campaigns at a statewide level. Currently, we work campus by campus. Now we're beginning to work on a system level. So last year, the Cal State University system passed a policy that had a 20% goal. That's 23 campuses. We're working in Maine right now. So that's one direction. I think ultimately the companies are going to have to step up because they have hundreds of campuses under their accounts at a time. So it's I think there is a path, but not it's a ways to go. Good question. Thank you.
One more. Anyone?
It's wonderful to hear about the work that you're doing at the university level. For some of us, it raises the question of how you might lead the way for K-12 schools in this country and also elsewhere for the children.
We are in conversation right now with School Food Focus and with Healthcare Without Harm on the hospital side to align our standards and to be able to make more coherent and powerful asks of the industry together. So the economics are really different at that, and I think it's important that each segment is organized because each has to have its own process. But there is a trend now to come together as the ed, the med, and the more we work with hospitals, the bed. Ed, med, bed together. We can.
Nice.
I need another ed word to wrap it up.
It's
there.
Pretty good though.
Sara and Anim traveled from the East Coast for this, so we're going to let them go and enjoy their dinner at Chez Panisse. And thank you all very much for coming.
Thank you. It's a pleasure.